I think that
the expectations, I'm glad you asked the question, asked it that way, even though he's going to be full go. He's going to be a guy that I'm going to watch very close. Him, we made some jokes about Jimmy Garoppolo and a couple other quarterbacks, because we have kind of given them a Hall of Fame career off of 5 to 7 games. And I've seen this happen in the NFL, that people have success in a half of a season, and then they come back and the league does have a book on them, and the adjustment that the league makes to them, that the player takes longer to adjust and the personnel around him takes longer to adjust. So Deshaun Watson, tremendous talent. Amazing what he did last season. They didn't even know he was going to do that. Man. I wouldn't be shocked at all to see him come back to the field, start making some mistakes with the football, and see his interception ratio go up, touchdown to interception ratio go up, and also to see his completion percentage maybe to go down. So for him to struggle in his second season, I wouldn't be surprised. It's not like I'm hoping for it, but when you go into NFL season, you got to be careful. To be careful of all the players that they think are, this is going to be their breakout year. Be ever so careful. There hadn't been enough film. He hadn't played enough to know that he is a bona fide superstar long term in this league.
And when we say it's the 6 starts, yeah, that sounds small, but it's really the last 4 starts, and that's even smarter. Those last 4 starts, the guy accounted for 17 touchdowns, had a quarterback rating of 120, around 120. I mean, he was spectacular on a team with no offensive line whatsoever, on a team that had to score a whole bunch of points because their defense was ravaged by injuries. So will he, listen, is he going to be a guy that quarterbacks a team to 35 points per game like they did last year? No. But here's why I am not as worried about his regression as I am other guys, and maybe it's confirmation bias. This is the guy I saw at Clemson. This is the guy that I saw for 2 years in college football be the best player in college football. Go up against the best team in college football in back-to-back years in the national championship game and be the best player on the field. He's the guy who, going into his draft, I did not understand why there wasn't more discussion that he should be the number one overall pick. So when that player, when he, that's at least who I thought he was going to be in my mind's eye, and then I see him take the field and I'm like, well, it worked. That is exactly who I thought he would be. So I listen.
And then I'll ask you the question, who was the last player you saw in college football that was dominant, that came into the NFL, and he was able to duplicate that dominance?
Immediately, nobody. I mean, Cam was the guy that I would pull
on. Who could
on.
Do it immediately, well, and who could sustain it, like we've seen the great quarterbacks or the great players do.
And would you call
Russell? It's a small list.
It's a very small list.
That's why I don't go off of college football, because the systems that they run are totally different. And the reason why, there's two reasons why he was, there were some question marks about his overall throwing ability. Number one, will that system work in the pros? That was the number one thing. College guys who have been successful running the type of system they run at Clemson have not been successful. So that was warranted. The other one was his inability to be accurate on his deep ball in college. That's not something people made up. Like, he was not that good on it. So people drew the conclusion, is he going to be able to avoid people and stay injury-free? Well, he got hurt the first year, mm-hmm. So that's a real thing. He's had two serious knee injuries. As a young player, that will be an issue, regardless of the rest of his career.
And I would say, if we want to go best case, worst case, and I'm not pulling these two quarterbacks because they also happen to be black quarterbacks, but best case is Russell Wilson, right? Who was, I don't know if you'd call him dominant in college, but he was very, very good at both his stops.
No, he was not dominant.
But he's very good at NC State and Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. Came into the league, was immediately good, and has sustained that level. The flip side is Robert Griffin, who was dominant in college, who his rookie year in Washington, with a bit of a gimmicky system, looked to be dominant as a pro, suffered a serious injury, and never got anywhere close to that level of play. Like, so we can, you can pull examples of either one of them. I just, you mentioned the deep ball concern. I thought that was one of the revelations about last year, because in the preseason he couldn't even throw the deep ball.
The thing is, can he duplicate that? Can he duplicate the consistency that he's never had? So I can't bake it in off of those four or five games. I can't do that. I've seen enough football and I've seen enough guys go the other way that I don't have it in me to be able to make that jump without seeing it.
What did you see in the six games he started, the seven that he played last year, that would lead you to believe he could be a success? There was something in him that is going to let him shine in some capacity in this league.
I saw him with mediocre personnel, especially from a running back standpoint and offensive line standpoint. When the offensive line broke down, when the plays, Jenna, were off schedule, he was magnificent. And utilizing the wide receivers
DeAndre Hopkins,
for their skill level. Will Fuller, what does he do? Man, he's a burner. Man, he took advantage of that. Nuke, this is the first time Nuke had a real quarterback, and Nuke was phenomenal in playing with him. So those were the things. Plays off schedule, he was amazing. And this is the first time that Bill O'Brien, as an offensive coordinator and play caller,
has been able
looked
to,
halfway decent.
Right. That's the other part of this is the head coach, who was known as, I mean, he was Brady's quarterback's coach. He's the offensive coordinator there. He goes to Penn State. He makes Christian Hackenberg look like a pro. He made Matt McGloin into a pro. And then he gets to Houston. And we joked about this when the show first started. Remember, it was Hoyer, Mallett, Yates, Whedon, Daniels, Fitzpatrick, Keenum, Schaub. He finally had a guy he could be creative with the play calling from a quarterback position, rather than a guy he had to just coach up to an adequate level. And you all of a sudden saw, oh, that's why Bill O'Brien was the hot prospect coming out of Penn State to go to the pros. See how they build on that this year as well.
The pressure shouldn't be on Deshaun Watson in his second year. The pressure should be on another person in Houston. It should be on J.J. Watt in that defense. Because if that defense returns to being a top five defense, it makes Deshaun Watson's job a lot easier.
A lot easier.
We're sitting around here talking about a young quarterback, what he can do. Hey, Mr. Defensive MVP, we need him to show back up. I know he's a Hall of Famer, but we ain't giving him his jacket yet. We need to see J.J. Watt and see him healthy and see him playing at a high level.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe here to get the latest from the show. Also, be sure to check out more of the best clips from First Things First, or go watch a few segments from our other shows on FS1.